And now for something completely different.
Watch us on YouTube. Listen on your favourite podcast platform. Or ask your smart speaker to play the podcast Leicester Till I Die.
Subscribe, like, follow and join in now.
Strap yourself in,
because we're set up, switched on and ready to go.
On Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
This podcast is proud to be part of the Talk Sport Fan Network.
Talk Sport, powered by fans.
Right, Chris.
All right. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, good day, good night, goodbye. Wherever you are in the world, welcome along. The 8th of March, 2023. International Women's Day, apparently, and I've got to start off by saying that we're a bit late starting today. Well, I was waiting for the ex-wife just to finish cleaning and dusting all the shelves, so before I could start, but there's half the viewers gone. Welcome along. Apparently, I didn't realise this, but it should have been International Women's Day yesterday, but you know how long it takes a woman to get ready. Anyway, good evening, especially welcome to Dave's missus if she's watching. Hello, how are you on this International Women's Day? On the day that we've announced losses of £92 million, do we have to sell James Maddison to survive? I don't, and I think when all this comes up, to be honest with you, I don't think it's that bad, because Top bought a load of extra shares, didn't he? But we will worry about that another time. Today, we're looking at the good, the bad and the ugly of the playoff finals. Because there was a time when there was a song out. Do you remember that? Didn't we have a lovely time of day? We went to Bangor. And we could have just changed Bangor for Wembley, because it was an annual day out for us. And we used to come back really, really disappointed. We had a couple of good ones, then we had a bit of time and we couldn't even get past the semis. You know what it's like when you've got a semi and you can't go any further. It's bad, isn't it? It's bad. But we are going to be looking, like I say, at the good, the bad, the ugly. Mike says, hello. Hi, Chris, are you okay? I am good. And I say, now the wife's done all the dusting and hoovering. Nate, his afternoon, Chris, hope you are well. Indeed, good afternoon to you over there in the good old US of A. And Mike, memories. Oh, memories of a long and distant world. Yeah, and you know now why I've never gone on the X Factor. Hey, look, if I'm old and think I can go back far enough, I think he's actually now finished with his Anne Summers doll and he's free to come on to the show. Let's bring him on. He's looking for it.
Sorry, just trying to escape the flak at your comments.
Hello, Mrs. Dave. Yeah. I'm going to make him a cup of tea.
Yeah, she's on it.
That's good. That is good.
All done.
I hope she brought you breakfast in bed this morning.
I can't remember. I didn't get up till later. Oh, I did. I was up early this morning. Yeah. We actually were travelling up to, I don't know, North Sussex. Is that a place? And to a charity there. And we got about within 10 minutes and they called me to say it was off. They got no power. So we spent 3 hours in the car together. But
you must have upset somebody up there to do that.
Yeah. Nice day, isn't it? We're building an arc at the moment because it's absolutely hammering down on the south coast.
Well, as long as you've got the women doing it, that's all right.
Yeah, well, I'm busy, aren't I?
Exactly. You know, we can't multitask. Mike says, hi, Dave.
Hi, Mike. You're right.
So, let us have a look because we are talking. There we go, in a minute. Playoff finals. First of all, I mean, there was a lot of sort of when they were first introduced, it did extend the season, didn't it?
It did, yeah. And to be fair, I mean, it got us in the playoffs enough times by finishing, what, fifth or sixth?
Yes.
But yeah, that was the idea, wasn't it? Stop the season, become boring.
Yes.
Whether it's a good idea or not, I still don't know. I think if you finish third, 10 points ahead of fourth, fifth and sixth, you really should go up.
But then if you finished 17th on goal difference, should you then not go down? Like you say, if you're in sixth, then you get into the set, you're happy. If you're third, then, and we've got a few of those to look at, believe you me.
It's a bit like rugby. You can win the championship in rugby and then still have to go in the playoffs.
I do not agree with that. I think if you win something, then that should be it. But I do like the playoffs, despite the fact that we didn't have a good start in them. But it gives the fans a day out at Wembley, although with all the semis being held there and everything, that's not even as special as it used to be, is it?
Destroyed the whole thing, hasn't it? Destroyed the whole thing.
Yes. I know they've got to pay for Wembley, but no, it should just be the finals. That's the idea anyway. Maybe we're just getting a little bit too old, Dave.
Well, they did it because so that everybody could get tickets, didn't they? That was their argument. But we know why they really did it.
They did it because they had to pay off, like you say, Wembley.
Yeah.
You know? But
I don't agree with
that. Over budget massively. Everybody, just a quick one before we get into the first playoff final. Do not forget, if you are on TikTok, give us a follow. Do not please follow Chris_Forian, which is also Chris LTID Forian. That is my personal one. I put one video up there just so I could get an account. I don't do anything on there at all, and you'll just be refused. I don't have any people following me on there apart from a couple of really close friends. I literally just use it to watch the videos. But if you go on TikTok and you search at LTID, well, the link is there in the description, at LTID TV. I uploaded about 15 new clips the other day, including Dave and his new Anne Summers doll. is there for your pleasure to see. Get following us on TikTok, and I hope to be, if TikTok's your thing, rather than YouTube shorts, you'll see them all there. Let's have a look at the first comment. They were nail-biting times. You said there, Dave, and let's have a look at the first one, because it was 1992. Now, the Premier League, I think, started the following year.
It was perfectly set up for us.
Yes. And we went down. We'd finished fourth that season. Ipswich had finished top with 84. Middlesbrough were second with 80. Derby County were third with 78. We were fourth with 77. Then, God, Cambridge United. And then Blackburn Rovers were in sixth with 74. So 3 points behind us. Although we had won two more, but they'd drawn a lot more games. Did you go to that one at all?
Yeah, I did. I was at the semi-final, of course, as well, against Cambridge, which was an incredible night down at Fielding Street. I mean, they had, I think they had Dion Dublin, Steve Claridge in their team then.
Yes.
And they were really pounding people. They were the Wimbledon of their day, and it was awesome. But I was so gutted at the final because Speedy dived. There was no shadow of doubt Speedy dived. But to be fair, they had a penalty that I think, who was it? Was it Muggleton saved it?
It was indeed, yes.
Yeah. So we, you know, it could have been worse, but I don't know. I think they just seemed a bit of a nervous that the year was born off. Thanks, Nate.
Yeah, but, I was going to say, cheers, mate.
Yeah. Christ, the 90s still, I reckon, is yesterday.
Yeah.
But I don't know. There just seemed a little bit of, after the Cambridge game, we thought we were invincible. And I think we'd done Blackburn twice. I think we'd had the double over them. And I don't know. I think we went in there maybe too confident. I certainly thought we were going to win it fairly easily, I must say.
Well, I think when you finish higher, we finished fourth, like you say. I'll check in a second how we did against Blackburn during the season. I mean, they had only just been, I think, taken over by Jack Walker.
Yeah.
Who was the, I believe it was Steel he was into, and he'd sold Steel, his Steel company to British Steel or whatever it was at the time. And was extremely rich. And I think that, you know, when they went on to win it, I think it was the first stage, you could say, of somebody buying the title. But Derby had been playing, let me just have a look who Derby were playing. Blackburn Rovers were playing Derby, And over the two legs, Blackburn won 5-4 on aggregate. Apparently, David Speedy was attacked by a number of Derby supporters after the final whistle. Who knew? And then, like you say, we'd got drawn against Cambridge United. First leg at the Abbey Stadium in May. And we took a late lead in the first half. First leg was being played at the Abbey Stadium. Yeah, the visitors took the lead in the first half. Dion Dublin headed down across from a short corner to Kevin Russell. So Dublin was playing for us, I think.
No, he wasn't, no.
Not at that time, was he?
No, he was playing for Cambridge then.
I think he just actually was trying to defend it, I think. And then to Kevin, remember Russell? Rooster Russell.
I do indeed.
Rooster Russell, eh? Bloody hell.
Brilliant.
He
scored in the second leg as well.
Yeah, with 15 minutes of the match remaining, Cambridge captain Danny O'Shea headed in an equaliser. That was 1-1. Right, and that second leg, we did tear them apart, didn't we?
Yeah, I didn't see the first leg. I couldn't get to it. I don't think it was enough tickets for a start, but I was playing cricket that day. And I know where I was playing. I was playing at Old Tiffs. And I was fine with it. 1-1 when I heard the result, and then when I heard how it all happened when it was late on, I thought, oh, here we go. But the second leg, it was awesome. I mean, Tommy Wright was unbelievable on the left, absolutely unstoppable. And it was fantastic. You know, the atmosphere at Filbert Street was typical evening game. I mean, people say about every ground at night in a cup game, buzzing, but that night it was buzzing, I tell you. And, you know, everybody was performing. It was absolutely incredible. The nerves just, unlike now where the nerves come in, the nerves just went after about half an hour or so. We just knew we were going to do them.
Tommy Wright, of course, who is now a policeman, I believe.
Oh, blimey. He's a bit little, isn't he?
I am sure I read he was being interviewed. He's the ex-player who is now a...
That could be the other Tommy Wright. We have two Tommy Wrights.
Did we? Ah, of course.
One was a tall centre forward.
It might have been the other one then.
You can't see him on that picture, I don't think.
No, I'm not sure. I can see Rooster only because of his bald head.
Yeah, and the Norman Royd.
Yeah. He was tall, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Nate says, looking forward to this show. I can't, I don't know a lot about the history. Obviously, I don't as well, because Mike says, no, Chris, same name only. So it was the other. It was the other, Tommy, right. Yeah, 6-1. I mean, when you, I think, like you say, it is a case of whether you're confident or not, but when you've just won, you know, a game and you played them, you know, you beat them 6-1, you're thinking.
It was 5 at home, Chris, wasn't it?
Sorry?
Was it 5-1 at home and then 1-1 away? Was it 6-2 on aggregate?
No, it was 1-1 away.
Yeah. And 5-1 at home? I'm sure it was. Anyway, it doesn't matter. We murdered them.
Yes. Oh, sorry. It was 5-0 it ended. We went through 6-1 on aggregate.
Oh, that's right. They didn't score, did they?
Yeah. They scored in the first leg.
In the first one, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we were on a high, and we didn't perform in the final. I don't think I just felt so numb afterwards, and the penalties. Blackburn looked much better than we were. Whether they prepared better or whether they just didn't think they got anything to lose, I don't know. And there's a certain guy called Alan Shearer who didn't even play. I don't think. I'm not even sure he was in the squad. But I'm sure they'd signed him or were about to sign him or something.
He was not in the squad at all. No, you're quite right. It was Brian Little's first playoff final for Leicester. I mean, what a lovely man. I had him on a show, the conversation show. And, you know, he hates the next playoff that we're going to talk about. But Carl Muggleton was in goal. Gary Mills, Whitlow, Hill, and Walsh. Yeah. And then James, Steve Thompson, Simon Grayson, Tommy Wright, Ian Ormeroyd, and Rooster Russell, as you can see there. The substitutes were Oldfield and Phil G. G came on for Tony James. But, I mean, it was disappointing. I mean, Steve Walsh accused Speedy of diving.
I thought he dived.
I think we all did.
Yeah, but the referee clearly didn't.
No, and you know, VAR wasn't around in them days.
Neither did Doug Leash, but then he wouldn't.
Brian Little said he was disappointed. There is no way he would point the finger at anyone. Kevin Dalglish said, Speedy had a clear shot at goal. The referee has given the penalty. We took it and we scored. Courtney, who was the referee.
Clear shot? I don't remember it being like that.
I don't either. But I thought he was going
around the outside of Walshy and he fell over Walshy's, thigh.
Well,
I can't remember him having a clear shot.
I don't think he was. He was right down the side, wasn't he?
I thought so. I was tempted to get my old videos out when you told me about this and have a look, but I thought no, because that'll spoil my remembering.
I have watched a few DVDs back, I tell you. YouTube clips, I mean.
Oh, right, okay.
David Courtney, who was the manager, who was the referee, George, said that he believed he made the correct decision, noting that he thought Walsh took Speedy out and that is what he gave. It wasn't to be for us. Mike says there Speedy definitely dived. Actually, guys, I am trying to get David Speedy to come on.
That would be interesting.
Yes, but he wants to... He's another one that wanted paying, actually, and I'm trying to negotiate a deal because they then asked me. He said, his agent it was who said, we do charge, but would you promote this for us? And I said, yeah, I'm happy to promote that for you, but I charge.
Yeah.
I said,
same amount. Yeah.
Blackburn Rovers, they finished fourth the next season. I think that's probably when they brought Shearer in, if he wasn't already in. They went on 2 years after that to, in the 94-95 season, to win the Premier League.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think, though, in fairness, I mean, yes, it, like I say, I would not argue that it was a dive or anything like that. I mean, Blackburn had the finance to then go on, didn't they? And like he says, good for you, Chris. Yes. Oh, cheeky sod, you know. But no, I mean, Blackburn, in fairness, like it or not, they did have the finance, I think, to go on and, you know, compete in the Premier League, yeah, where
we wouldn't have been able to.
We wouldn't have won, would we, really?
No, we didn't have the players capable of playing in that league at the time.
Yeah. No, I mean, it was Jack Walker's dosh, quite right, yes.
Yeah, I mean, right, Ormond-Royd, Russell, they wouldn't have had a chance, I'm afraid. I mean, it's a shame, but they wouldn't. I mean, Steve Thompson, probably, who I thought was really classy.
Yes.
He might have, and Walshy, of course, did. Gary Mills, maybe, but I'm not sure. Was it Colin Hill, wasn't it, and Whitlow at the back? I don't know. You'd like to think they could, but I don't think so. Well, actually, we'll talk about it later. I know, but it proved that, didn't it, when we went up that time?
Yes, yes. I mean, when you look at that, I don't think Cole Muggleton, I think he would have had a season to forget had we gone up. You know, bless him. Like you say, he did save the first penalty attempt. I don't think Speedy took that first penalty, did he?
No. It was, I think it was one of our boys, McNeil, wasn't it? Mike Newell?
Yes, it was. Yes, of course.
We sold him on to, I don't think we sold him to Blackburn, did we? Did we sell him to not Leeds or somebody like that? We certainly didn't sell him to Blackburn, I don't think, but we...
No, we sold him to Everton.
Everton, that's it, yeah.
And then he went on to play 130 games and only scored 28 goals for Blackburn. Until he ended up at Blackpool, as it happened. Apparently, he was a rock for them. Come on. Hey, the first of the night. But yeah, in fairness.
Well, he was a towering player, wasn't he?
Oh, boom, get back at me there. Come on. You know what I mean? I always have to, you know, acknowledge my peers. And say that you light up my life.
Oh, I know. Actually, Blackpool gave me a new view of Pleasure Beach. I never realised it was funfair rides.
Yeah. You just thought it was a very popular trip club.
Yeah, indeed.
I have got a story about Blackpool. Because I lived in Blackpool for 2 years, and I have got a story about a strip club in Blackpool, but this is not the time or place for it. I will one day when we do a late show. Hello, Mrs. Dave.
She's just going to make me a cup of tea, bless her.
Oh, good, bless her. Mine's white with 2 sugar, please.
Okay.
Mike says, oh, my God. But, yeah, what was I going to say? When you look at the team, I mean, they actually went on the following season to finish fourth.
Yeah.
Now, for a team that's got promoted, you know, we've seen it before. Blackpool, when they got promoted, they went top for a while. But to actually finish fourth was really good.
Yeah, I think we
couldn't have competed with that, could we?
No, I think Doug Leash was building them up over the season, which is why they scraped in the playoffs, really. But he got them peaking at the right time, no doubt about it. And they were better than us, really, if I'm honest. I think when you have a game like that, you like Southampton on Saturday, I still think we were poor, but people are saying, well, if we'd have took our chances, we'd have been 4-1 or something. And I never see games like that. I find it very difficult to do that. To me,
when you look at the players that he then brought in the following season, Bobby Mims was really the only goalkeeper of note. Henningberg.
Oh, yeah.
Who went on, I think, to Manchester United. Colin Hendry. Graham Lasso. David May. Steve Agnew, one of our old guys. Kevin Moran, captain.
Tim Sherwood.
Stuart Ripley. Jason Wilcock. Yeah, Alan Shearer. Kevin Gallagher. Names that went on and, you know, went on to other clubs as well. But when you look at, you know, that investment, I don't think any of those players, Mims was in goal still. Kevin Moran was there and Hendry was. Newell, all those others that I've named were brought in over the summer. And obviously we know eventually they went on to win the damn thing. But yes, we felt a bit miffed, certainly. And it was a long way to go. A long way to go for to lose. And Wembley's never a good place when you lose, is it?
Yeah, it's over 30 years ago.
Oh, good God. Well, thank you for making me feel old.
I just thought of that.
You're making me feel worse than Nate did when he said it was the year after he was born. Now we know how old Nate is. Yeah. But you know, not to be deterred, and there were great times under Brian Little. I mean, we'd struggled before with different managers. Pleat, God Almighty. But Brian Little came in. Lovely guy. Like I say, check out the show I did with him on YouTube. It's under the Conversation banner. And it was exciting times. And we went back the following season because, you know, we weren't going to let it get to us. But this one hurt even more.
Yeah, it did. And actually, we only just scraped in the playoffs that year, I think. We finished about... I think we finished sixth or something like that.
We did. That year, Newcastle United were top.
Oh, they murdered us, didn't they, at Filbert Street?
Yes,
in the last
they did.
Game. Yeah, I remember that.
I think Keegan was manager, wasn't he?
He was, yeah. We were
96 points. West Ham were second with 88. Portsmouth were third with 88.
I know
they missed out on goal difference, six goals. Tranmere Rovers were fourth.
With
79, and then Swindon were fifth with 76, and Leicester were sixth with 76.
I'm going to say, I know Pompey were 10 points clear of us, and we beat them.
I mean, like you say, it doesn't go any further on the table, unfortunately, but you know, it was fifth versus sixth, and like you say, you know. Portsmouth would have a claim for going up because, you know, they were nine points ahead of Tranmere Rovers. But look, they know the ground rules at the start of the season. They've got to get in.
They played the first leg at Forest as well, if you remember.
Who?
Leicester Portsmouth. The first game was played at Forest.
Was it? Do you remember why was that?
Yeah, we were building that new stand. It was all planned to be the end of the season. Now, whether they thought Leicester would go up automatically or whether they thought we wouldn't get a sniff, they planned it all and got all the contractors ready and everything. So they had to take that stand apart and we had to go and play at the City.
Was that the Carling stand?
Yeah.
In fairness, we needed something, though, didn't we?
We certainly did.
You know, you could get one man and his dog in the old Filbert Street before that. Swindon finished 12 points behind West Ham in second, you know. But like we say, at the start of the season, everybody knows what it was. Swindon faced Tranmere Rovers in theirs. And, it was another close game, but on the two legs it was 5-4 on aggregate. I've got to say, mate, your memory is amazing. The match was hosted at Nottingham Forest home stadium.
And I remember the away leg as well. I think Ormondroyd might have scored, but I'm sure it was offside. But nothing was given. There was something weird about winning goal.
In the first leg, the game was described by Paul Weaver in The Guardian as dreadful.
It was awful.
But he said it was redeemed by Julian Joachim's only goal of the match.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Which went on to be Brian Little's favourite goal ever for Leicester.
I think he was on the bench as well, wasn't he, Joachim? came off the bench and did it.
I'm not sure for the semis, to be honest with you. Now, you know, it's... Because if you also, if you go on the website, leicestertillidie.com, and go under specials, and there's a page called Favourite Things. Okay. And what I've done, I've got ex-players and managers that gave me their, like, favourite game, favourite match, favourite player, favourite teammate, etc. And his favourite goal, he said, it was that goal. He said he just took that ball and ran with it. Second leg, we were back down at Fratton Park. 3 days later, my God, 3 days later, for the hell, these days, they've been claiming they're tired. Goalless at half-time, and then 6 minutes in the second half, Portsmouth took the lead. Within 2 minutes, we'd equalised, like you said, when Ian Ormeroyd found the target following a deflected shot from David Oldfield. Steve Thompson, I like Steve Thompson, I must admit.
I did. But
Leicester head in the 69th minute with a shot from the edge of the penalty area, beating the Portsmouth goalkeeper Alan Knight. 3 minutes later, Bjorn Christensen levelled the score once more with an 18-yard curling shot. Game ended 2-2, but of course we'd won the first leg 1-0 and we were into the playoff final down at Wembley. Didn't we have a lovely time today? We went to Wembley again.
I played in a veterans game against Alan Knight many years ago, and I did remind him of it. Ormeroyd 2-1.
You could not remind him of it.
It had to be done. He said, what do? You live in Surrey. We're everywhere, mate. We're everywhere.
The thing with this, so we're into the final. We're up against Swindon, another team that was rebuilding under a well-known manager in Glenn Hoddle. Do you remember where Steve Walsh played in that game?
I think he played up front.
He was our top scorer that season.
Yeah.
Steve Walsh.
He'd been injured a lot or sent off a lot, hadn't he?
He was the most... I think he still holds the record for the most sendings offs in the Premier League or something like that.
I think him and Brian Little fell out or something happened, or he was injured. There was certainly something happened and he didn't play for a while. So
he was there. He was there when Little left. And it was Peter Taylor, I know, that fell out with him. Because, of course, he was there under O'Neill. Our starting 11 was Poole, Gary Mills, who was captain, Whitlow, Richard Smith, who'd been on the channel as well, Steve Walsh, then Colin Hill, David Oldfield, Steve Thompson, Julian Joachim, Steve Agnew, Lee Philpott. And our substitutes are Ian Ormeroyd and Colin Gibson. Mm-hmm. I mean, this has got... I still think, for me, it is still... I know the result didn't go our way, but for me, it is still one of the... I think the best playoff final there's been.
Maybe. Although I remember vividly, we were... Because, you know, you had half the ground each. Brilliant colours, red, blue. But I remember sitting... sort of on the penalty box. Sorry, what the hell am I talking about? The box.
If you just sat on the penalty box, the stewards would have carried you away.
I've gone all emotional now thinking about it. And I saw Hoddle moving away. Swindon had the ball on the left. This is how I remember it anyway. And I saw Hoddle moving away on the right. And I said to the guy sitting next to him, Hoddle's free, nobody's picking him up. And he just drifted away and he picked the ball up and scored. And I was screaming at him, pick him up, pick him up. Of course, you know, nobody could hear me, but that's my vivid memory of it. But also the penalty, which was never a penalty. That was bloody, what's his name in his last game, wasn't it? Oh, what the little bald-headed guy, was it?
Paul Bowden scored for Swindon.
Yeah, who the hell was the penalty? He was his. I'm sure
Colin Hill.
The referee.
Oh, David Ellery was the referee.
Ellery, that's him. Yeah, never too keen on him.
No.
I think Kevin Poole pulled away, didn't he? He came back with his hands up or something, and nobody tackled him from behind and just went over. And, you know, we talk about cheating a lot on here.
Yeah.
That was cheating, and he got away with it. And then Hoddle went.
You know, I don't want to see it. And you know my thoughts on that.
Yeah.
You can check any program to see my thoughts on that. But I guess if it had gone the other way, we wouldn't have argued. But I mean, I lived at that time in Lancashire. I think I was in, not sure if I was in Burnley or not. I might have been there. I think I was actually in Blackburn at the time. And I didn't think that the playoff final was going to be shown around the country because it was too. When it comes to ITV regions, Swindon were at that time under Central, yeah, which was obviously the old ATV, the Midlands ITV channel. So I, with my girlfriend, which was to be my future wife, drove all the way down from Blackburn to Leicester to my mum's to watch it on Central TV. I have never gone through so many emotions in a match. I mean, 1-0 at half time. And I said, we need a goal straight after the half-time break. There was a goal, and it went to Swindon. Maskell scoring. Ooh. So I'm like, oh, God, no. And I said, right, if we don't get another goal soon, we definitely need a goal. And, of course, Swindon went and got the third. So I don't know about you, but I'm sat at home, and I'm kind of like, well, not at my mum's house, and I'm kind of like resigned to losing. You know, and I'm like, oh, God, 3-0 down. Yeah. And then Joachim gets one on 57. And you think, okay, it's a consolation. Do you know what I mean? And then Steve Walsh gets one on the 68th minute. And you suddenly start to think, oh, hang on a minute. What's going on here? And then Thompson with...
Oh, yeah, I remember. That was a good goal.
It was yeah, an amazing goal. I mean, he went through. I think he fooled the goalkeeper with a lovely little touch, yeah, and put it in. And it was 3-3, and it was like unbelievable. Again, my emotions had changed 100%. And then on the 84th minute, we had this penalty. Well, the penalty you can see there. I mean, oh, it was heartbreaking. I that's 3-hour journey back home, and I don't think I spoke to my girlfriend once. She was driving. I was just in total silence. What a mixed emotions.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I ended up walking out with a load of Swindon fans as well, but they're all very pleasant.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. Yeah. I'm sure they were happy.
They were. I was trying very hard to be nice and calm. But yes. If we'd have lost on a wonder goal or a normal goal, I'd have said fine. But it was clearly not a penalty. I mean, okay, I was, you know, 150 yards or whatever at the other end, but there was no way it was a penalty. And it was just gut-wrenching. And I did wonder the next year whether they'd recover from it, you know, whether they'd be strong enough. It was a bit like the recent ones. Whether he'd be good enough to come back again and have another go.
Yes.
But I think he cleared it out. I mean, Speedy was playing for us then, but he was suspended because he...
Yes, he was. Yeah.
In Portsmouth, didn't he?
Go out and buy the players that go down for fouls against you, and then you are fine, you know. That's the thing to do. But we did go out and buy him. And I believe he had a thing signed in his contract that if we got promoted, we didn't sell him, because obviously that's what Blackburn did. Playing right back at number two for Swindon Town was a future Leicester City player, Nicky Summerby.
Oh, blimey. Yeah.
Who, if I remember correctly, actually played for no money because he hadn't got a club. We'd gone into administration and couldn't sign anybody.
Yes, I think you're right.
And yet he came, and just so that he was playing, and so total respect, 100% respect to the guy. I mean, again, do you think we would have made any difference that season?
I think with Julian Joachim coming through, maybe, in a fit while she and Richard Smith was a decent centre half. Millsy, yeah. Kevin Paul, don't know. Who else was a Steve Agnew, Phil Pop? No, maybe yeah. not.
We would have struggled, but yeah, then, in fairness, most playoff teams do, if we're honest.
Well, they did in those days, yeah.
They didn't have long to sort of rebuild, did they? Because the game was so much... Well, was it a month or so after the end of the season by the time you played the two legs and everything? Yeah. So you were playing catch-up with the signings, but in fairness, Swindon didn't do very well, did they? Because they came straight back down again.
Well, Glenda went to play a manager at Chelsea, didn't he, within about 3 weeks?
Yes, yes.
I think on the... Was it they had a tour around Swindon, which was interesting, open-top bus, and I think...
Yes.
Didn't they all, that, like we had with Martin O'Neill, you know, saying, please stay or something like this, or don't go. But I think he'd already decided that whatever happened that day, he was off to play a manager at Chelsea.
Yeah, thousands of fans held aloft banners. In the final plea.
Was it?
Okay. In a final plea to the management duo to remain at the club. Yes.
Was it John Gorman that was
John Gorman, it was indeed, sir. Yes, yeah.
No idea what I did yesterday.
You didn't speak to John Gorman, did you?
No, I said, no. I said I have no idea what I did yesterday.
Oh, I see what you mean. But you can remember that. Yeah. The Independent's Trevor Haylett described the match as an absolute cracker and that the late penalty was the last act of a heart-stopping drama. Yeah. Little was stoic about the late penalty award, saying, I was surprised it was given. But I'm not going to change the decision. I mind that's true. No matter what, how much you throw everything up and go mad and throw your toys out the pram, you're not going to get it was changing.
But Ferguson did it successfully, didn't he, when he threw his toys out? And next time, he got the decision.
Well, yeah, that's fair. But we didn't, you know, we weren't to know if there's going to be another playoff final for us. And it's funny thing about Brian Little, he almost said, like, well, it happened to us last year. Just read the same, let me read you the same speech out, sort of thing. But like you say, Glenn Hoddle left Swindon for Chelsea 4 days after the match. And obviously went on to be England manager and an erstwhile faith healer. As Mike says there, I've got to say, in those days, Wembley was our second home ground. It really, really was.
I think the Swindon game was, I met, just walking past, my old schoolmate, Bill Brinley, who Bill goes to every game now, whatever it may be, home and away. I think he goes with his daughter, I'm not sure, but he was a year younger than me at school. And that, you know, we were two of the main guys at the school that supported Leicester, believe it or not. So he's a massive supporter. And, you know, he sees it all. But he was just walking down past Wembley and I was just standing there taking in the atmosphere. I think my mother was there as well, for goodness sake. And I just recognised him. It was incredible. Out of all those people, 100,000, no, probably 80,000 people in those days, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And just happened to walk past him, which I know digresses, but I must tell you another story.
Yeah,
there's a lady that I used to go on Wayne Fleet coaches with to games. They're from Wayne Fleet from the Neaton. And I've seen her at three of the away games I've been to this year and about five of the home games. I've seen her every time. Just randomly, and that is incredible. I mean, the only, you know, she's obviously aged. What would we be?
Who's this we're talking about? Sorry,
it's a young lady that used to come on the coach when she.
Oh, right, all right, with you. Sorry, yeah.
From Newton, and I just saw her. It must be 50 years later or more now, and she's still going.
Is there anything you want to share with us about her?
No, not really. I just saw her at a ground and said,
Mrs. Dave next to you there. Hello, Mrs. Dave, still.
I think she's washing up.
Well, on International Women's Day, what else would you be doing?
I just said, are you from Nuneaton? She said, yeah.
There's nothing I can remember. I'm just to sidetrack on that as well. There's nothing like football for bringing people together and, you know, like you say, memories. And you bump into people that, like you say, you haven't seen for ages. And, you know, Took a step further. I went on, this is going to sound very posh, I went on a cruise to Norway, and we were up above the Arctic Circle, so right up Norway, around the top edge, and then we'd gone 2 hours into the drive into inland to this campsite-y thing with a big tent where you could hot drink to try and see the Northern Lights. And I'm stood there, and you've got scarves on and hats because it's bloody freezing, if I'm honest with you. Midnight, this was, trying to see the Northern Lights. And suddenly somebody shouts out from behind, Leicester City! And I thought, well, that sounds like a bit of an accent, so it can't be somebody that's on the cruise, surely. And I turned round, and it was one of the local guides that says, Jamie Vardy and and I'm like, bloody hell, all that way. And you meet someone because I've got a Leicester scarf on. So he recognised the Leicester scarf. But football is unbelievable. But no, Swindon finished bottom the following season when they got promoted. Yeah. So good evening, Terry. How are you? And good evening, David, as well. They finished bottom, were relegated back to the second tier. There is. Totally not. Again, just very blame Dave for this, but I was in a safari in Africa. It sounds like I have very posh holidays. Can I just say I don't? But I decided that my last three holidays were better than the rest of them all put together. But as I was doing a safari, and when you leave Johannesburg to go to sort of where the safari is based, it's like a seven-hour drive because it's a bloody big country, South Africa. And I had not met anybody else there who was particularly a football fan. And this woman came up to me, very nice young lady, and said, oh, sorry to bother you. Do you mind if my husband just sits with you for a bit? And now, this was American, they were American. I went, and she said, no, don't. She said, he loves English soccer, you know? And I went, no, tell him. Now, this guy, he was American. He was a very, very well-spoken guy. He loved, he was following American soccer and was a big fan of Liverpool's and had actually been to the King Power to watch Leicester when he was over because he'd like to go to different football grounds. Can I just say that for the next 6 hours, she never saw him. He literally just sat there talking football. And for most, and I've got to be honest with you, when we sat together for most of the rest of the holiday, but we didn't leave her out, obviously. But like you say, right, there is no better conversation starter.
No.
Terry says, was the woman on his coach on the cruise as well? Well, we'll have a comparison, but I don't think so. But look, we'd lost two.
She's got the same length hair as she had when she was 16, anyway.
we're getting too much into this. But anyway, 1993, when we lost again. I mean, I'd say it took a long time for me to sort of get, certainly the three-hour journey back, I never said a word. I've never gone through so many different emotions in such a small space of time. And like you say, it was going to be interesting to see what happened the following season and how we reacted. And, well, we didn't react that badly. Because in 1994, that's the wrong one.
Yeah, which Silence of the Rams.
Silence of the Rams, indeed. Yeah. Oh. Now, this was, Steve Walsh was played up front for this game.
Yeah.
And do you remember how we got, this season, we actually finished above Derby County. Palace actually were top. Believe it or not, Nottingham Forest were second. Millwall were third. Sorry, just read Mike's comment here. We are beginning to sound very old.
Indeed.
We are. Oh, when I was a lad, you know. I mean, I don't know if you saw right at the start. This is the graphic I have. But then, so Nottingham Forest finished second. They both went up automatically. Millwall third, Leicester fourth with 73. Millwall had 74, Tranmere had 72, and Derby in sixth had 71. Forest went, say, second with 83, and Palace top with 90. So we played Tranmere Rovers, who, of course, we would go on to meet later years, some 6 years later, in a League Cup final. The first leg was away at Prenton Park. Don't know if you were there for that one.
No.
It was a 0-0, and the best chances fall into the home side, John Aldrich, my God, who, of course,
he was later
manager.
Yep.
And it was saved by the fingertips of Gavin Ward, third playoff final, third keeper.
Oh, yeah. I'm not sure we had as good a side then, you know.
I think we had a decent side.
The year before was better. I do, yeah. I remember thinking that. I mean, had we signed Ewan Roberts by then? I'm sure Ewan Roberts played. And Noel Blake, wasn't it? He was a
Ewan
decent
Roberts, we definitely player. Did. Mark Blake.
Yeah, he was a decent midfielder. But I'm not sure. You know, the team was that much better. Simon Grayson.
We had Gavin Ward in goal. We had Coatsworth, Grayson, Carey, and Willis at the back. And Whitlow as well. I don't know if it was Brian Carey or Mike Whitlow, but they had less hair than we had, even back then. He looked about 60, one of them. We had, I say, Whitlow, Mark Blake, Colin Gibson, Steve Walsh up front with Ewan Roberts and Ian Ormeroyd. On the bench, we had, because we were allowed three substitutes by this point, gone up from two to three, Kevin Poole, Steve Thompson and Julian Joachim.
Yeah, I think one had to be a goalkeeper, didn't it?
It did, yeah. Kevin Poole was that man.
Yeah.
Joachim replaced Roberts on 56 minutes. Thompson's replacing Coatsworth on 68. It's funny, really, because Joachim and Thompson, who had been so involved in the last season's playoff final, were only on the bench for this one.
Yeah, I think that was because Blake was in it, but I thought Steve Thompson was far classier than the rest of them.
Thanks for popping in, Mike. By the way, you got to look after on International Women's Day, haven't you? So go and watch a film with her.
I thought that was yesterday.
No, as I say, it takes them so long to get ready that it was meant to be yesterday, but it's today.
I couldn't possibly comment on that.
Going back
to the semis for Millwall, Casey Keller played in goal for them.
Yes.
Because we signed him not too long after that, I don't think. Probably 3 or 4 years after that, wasn't it?
We played Tranmere Rovers in the semis.
I'm saying Casey Keller played in the other one.
Oh, right. For Millwall.
The Millwall derby.
I like Casey Keller. He wasn't Millwall, you're quite right. Yeah, I like Casey Keller. I have to be honest with you. But the first leg, like I say, at Prenton Park was 0-0. The return leg 3 days later again at Filbert Street. In the last moments of the first half, Leicester took the lead. Mark Blake shot it the post and Ian Ormeroyd converted the rebound. I mean, Ian Ormeroyd, the original Peter Crouch.
Yeah, definitely.
You know. Now then, it gets interesting.
Got him from Derby.
A minute into the second half, Pat Nevin levelled the score by converting a Jed Brennan cross. David Speedy, a second-half substitute, then restored Leicester's leads, 4 minutes remaining, heading in a free kick from Blake. With only seconds of the match remaining, an altercation between Speedy and the Tranmere keeper, Eric Nixon, resulted in both players being sent off.
Yeah.
The match ended 2-1, and that's why Speedy wasn't, of course, in the final.
Yeah, I got that wrong. It's that year, wasn't it? Yeah, I remember now.
you remember more than I do, mate. I'm reading it here from.
But he got a contract. He got a contract as well, didn't he? Though.
Yes, he did. Yeah. It was Derby's first appearance in the playoff final.
Interesting team selection for the final. With Joachim not playing, I think he'd had a decent season.
Well, like I said, and Thompson as well.
Thompson, strange.
Yeah. You had on the Derby side, you had Marco Gabbiadini who went on.
Yeah.
He played for 12 different clubs and got 226 goals. Was it Paul Kitson, ex Leicester player again?
Yeah.
That was in their side. And their big hope was Tommy Johnson. It kicked off on 30th of May 1984. Third time lucky. Steve Walsh, super Steve Walsh, two goals in the 41st and the 84th minute.
That goal was ridiculous. I don't know what Derby defenders were thinking of. I mean, it went under his foot, I think. It was such a fluke goal. I don't know. I really don't know what they were thinking.
Was it the first or second goal?
First one. Oh, so Allman Royd scored. It's headed for the second, and it was a good save. And then Walshy just tapped it in.
That's the one I'm thinking of. Yes.
The first one, I think Walshy headed it, and it seemed to not bounce. And
went the defender bent over to head it. And it went over his head.
Over his head, and then it's under somebody's foot. I'm sure it was just a catalogue of disasters for them, which was great.
Yes, it was. We
needed a bit of luck for a change.
I'm just saying, don't.
And I remember the referee as well. Was it that guy with the fuzzy grey hair? I think it was his. They all seem to give referees their retirement game in the playoff final. And what was his name? You remember him? He had very tight shorts and very.
The referee was Roger Milford.
Roger, that's him. Yeah, he was all right. He was a decent referee.
Yeah. Was it the first goal? I can't know whether I'm getting the matches mixed up now, but there was one goal, I think it was this one, where the Leicester player, which obviously would have been Steve Walsh, headed it towards the goal. Their defender bent down to head it, and it went over his head. And into the net.
Yeah, and I'm sure there was under the foot involved as well, but maybe not.
For the second goal, it went in. Like you say, the goalkeeper made a good save for Derby. Yeah. Hi, Anthony, by the way. Roger Milford, the referee from Bristol, where Anthony's from.
Good referee. Was
full of referees, obviously.
Good referee.
I think, and then it sort of fell to Walshy, but I think he kind of scuffed it in. I think he scuffed it in, but I don't think he could have necessarily missed it.
I think I was too busy jumping up for the goal. I thought Allman Royd was going to score.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was all a bit bizarre because you could probably see me by Walsh's right hand up there somewhere. I'm sure that's where I was. I couldn't get behind the goal for some reason. Always that spot there.
Brian Little was absolutely overcome with emotion. I mean, you were there. This was the third one you'd been to.
It was awesome.
How was it feel? I mean, it must have been when that final whistle went, because it was a tight game, 2-1.
Yeah.
It must have been, must have been mad.
Yeah, it was. But you know what? The biggest thing I wanted to do was to get out the ground, get back to Surrey, and go and see my mate down the cricket club who was playing a Sunday game of cricket that I should have been playing in. Sorry, no, it's Monday, wasn't it? Bank Holiday Monday, was supposed to be playing in as well, and just get there beyond and get the bar open and just rub it in. Because he was a Southern Derby fan. I don't know why. He just had this thing about Derby years ago. And this was a great moment. Only superseded, well... Yeah, best ever moment. Second best is when we did them. Was it 4 or 5-1 at their place?
Yes, four goals in about the first 16 minutes. All headers. All headers.
I was in the pub with about half a dozen Derby fans, and I didn't get to that game, but I was in the pub, and they all left. About half an hour, they'd gone. Yes. I had to buy me beers for the rest of the game.
It was on Sky, that one, as well. That was one of the few times you used to win on Sky.
Yeah. No, that moment, Chris, the relief when the whistle went, the actual relief was almost exhausting, because you just didn't believe it was going to happen. We kept going. We kept, as Mickey Adams said, we kept the faith. But deep down, I don't think we really believed we were going to beat Derby. But the players did. And on a pretty hot day, I think they're all hot days from what I remember. It was incredible. Absolutely incredible.
It was, I mean, Brian Little would admit it wasn't the best game.
No.
But it was the result that mattered more than the performance for this game.
Yeah.
I know Steve Walsh coming out saying, thank God we didn't lose for a third time on the row. Following season, Derby County ended ninth place in the first division, 6 points below the final playoff places. Of course, we came straight back down again. Three places and 19 points from safety.
But
there's a lot of speculation. What are your thoughts? Brian Little obviously left, and it caused a lot of bad feeling. Mm. And he went to Aston Villa. Now, I don't think Brian Little would have left if he'd been offered the job at Everton.
No.
Or if he'd been offered the job at Forest or wherever. But Villa was his club.
Yeah.
And do you remember when Mike O'Neill left as well? He refused Leeds, he refused Everton, and he went to Celtic because it was his club. All right, maybe he could have left in a better way, but, you know, the problem is, when it's your club comes knocking like that, and it's like, you know, Brian Potter at Chelsea, everybody's got their club, you know, players, managers, fans, etc. Of course we have. And I think when the chance comes to play for your club, if you're a player or manager your club, then you can't turn it down because you don't know if that chance will ever come up again.
No, you're right, and I wasn't surprised, especially after the season we had in 1995, because we were bad. And I was kindly invited to Chelsea in the players' bar and everything else by a mate of mine who used to work there. And I remember coming out of the players' lounge after half-time as the players were coming out, and I looked at Brian Little and I went, you know, we were about three or four down at the time, I think, or three. And he just went, shrugged his shoulders. I don't know. Mm. And I thought, well, that's it then. If he don't know what's going on, we got a big problem here.
Yes.
And I think that probably helped make his mind up, because we weren't good enough. I mean, we had people, I mean, bless them, thank you for what they did, but Gary Coatsworth, Carey, Willis, Whitlow, they weren't Premier League players.
No.
And
one Premier League player we did bring in, I think he was actually from Notts County. I think whether he was our first £1 million player, Mark Draper.
Yeah, what a player. But he didn't last long. He had a problem.
Well, he went to Villa. He followed Brian up to Villa, as did Julian Joachim.
Yeah, no. There's something really weird about all that, wasn't there? So I don't think Leicester handled it as well as they could have done. I never found out exactly what happened. I mean, all we did was got the Judas signs. Well, I didn't, but got the Judas signs out when he came back, which I thought was a little unfair. But then,
I think so, because I think he saved our club because we were going nowhere before he came in.
He changed the attitude. He changed the mentality of it. And he also started to get us on the road to commercialism, I think, or sort of went along with it.
Because Barry Pierpoint became the club's first chief executive.
Yeah.
And again, guys, get onto the YouTube site, LTID TV, check out the conversation heading, and you'll see Brian Little's interview with me, you'll see Barry Pierpoint. They actually got on very well. They introduced Family Night Fridays, or whatever it was called.
Yeah.
And they did, you know, bring in commercialism. But he left. Mark McGee came in. He wanted to play very, very nice football.
He did play nice football.
Yeah. And the thing is, I think we weren't in the position at the bottom of the table. We just needed to hoof the ball up and score goals.
Yeah, but he did all right. He did all right. But then he got turned by Ferguson, didn't he? Same yeah. Wolves for a bigger club. Yeah. You know, now he regrets it. I think I've seen him publicly state that he regretted what he did.
Well, I mean, the funny thing with and this is the thing with fans, isn't it? Is that I hated him, and I think I hated him for the saying that Wolves were the bigger club. That's what hurt, I think. But we didn't mind when he walked out on Reading to join us.
No, exactly.
this is good. Being a fan, it's very, 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 very fickle, isn't it?
A bit like Holloway, isn't it, really?
But, you know. Look, it came down. We weren't to know what was going to happen because, obviously, you know, Little left. McGee came in. We got relegated very early into the next season. He walked out, like I say, to go to Wolves. And then we got Sir Martin coming in,
yeah.
Mr. Martin O'Neill. And he will always say... Sorry?
He did a Ferguson, didn't he? Was it 11, 12 games with nothing?
Yes, he did.
He always says
he remembers the, and I don't remember the day, but I think it was the Sheffield United game where the fans were going absolutely mad at him. It's always ingrained in his memory. But my God, what a time was to come. And We'd lost two out of three, then we won out of three, won the third one, got relegated, went back for a fourth time I've not loaded it. Where is it? There it is, 1996. Yeah, Palace and Leicester City. We will always remember that for the shin, won't we?
Yeah, but I reckon we had, 2 years difference, yeah? Two seasons difference, I reckon we probably only had. I think Kevin Poole played in goal, didn't he? We talked about that the other day.
Yes.
And Kallack.
Win it for you.
Yeah. I think we only had about four players from the 94 playoff final in that final.
Let's have a look, shall we?
Midfield and forward line changed, I think.
Well, yeah. I mean, Kevin Poole.
Came back in for Ward.
Simon Grayson, Julian Watts, the friend of the station, used to do a lot with us.
Mike Whitlow
played. Julian Watts, he says, my claim to fame is that I put the cross in for Steve Clarish to shin it. Yeah. Steve Walsh was the other defender. Then we had Gary Parker, Muzzy Izzet, Neil Lennon, Scott Taylor, Emil Heskey, and Steve Claridge. Substitutes then were Mark Robbins, who came on in the 101st minute. He replaced Scott Taylor. Colin Hill came on in 118 minutes to replace Steve Walsh.
Steve Walsh, yeah.
And, of course, who can ever forget Zelko Kalic coming on in the 119th minute to replace Kevin Poole. But just to look at how we got there, Sunderland had won the second tier, 83 points. Derby County, funnily enough, that year was second and went up, although they weren't to have a very good season when they went up, still holding the record for the lowest number of points in the Premier League. Palace were third with 75. Stoke City fourth with 73, Leicester fifth on goal difference, 71, and sixth Charlton Athletic also on 71. Yeah. Playoff semi, we went to Stoke.
We did. That was a tough place to go. That was a horrible ground to go to, really. Yeah, Graham Potter played in that game.
That was going to be my next thing.
Sorry.
Have you got Wikipedia open as well?
I wouldn't know how to get two things opened on this.
But yes, Graham Potter, Kevin Poole made a save in the 5th minute from Graham Potter.
Oh, I can't remember that, but I remember him playing because he didn't score many goals anyway, did he? Was he a midfielder or something like that?
I have no idea. But Michael Walker in The Guardian compared the save to Gordon Banks' save of the century against Pele.
Oh, God, I can't remember it.
I can't remember it being but apparently it was. The second leg again played 3 days later at the Victoria Ground in Stoke. After the goalless first half, Gary Parker put Leicester City ahead just 30 seconds into the second. He'd been restored to the team after 10 games following a disagreement with manager Martin O'Neill.
Yeah, that's right. I didn't think he was going to be able to play.
I liked Gary Parker. I thought he was absolutely...
He had a bit of a Madders attitude, didn't he? Madison's a bit like him in a way. Mm. And I think he's a better... Madison's a much better player. But, they had that sort of arrogance, the way they played, which is great when they're playing for you.
Yes.
I just used to love it when he got a penalty. He always said Parker Penn. used to crack my girls up, I tell you, Parker Penn.
in the other game, 3-1 to Crystal Palace over Charlton Athletic. Back to Wembley. Good evening, Doug. I love your comment. I'll bring that up in a second, actually, because we're going to take a little break in a minute.
Harry Bassett was in charge at Palace, wasn't he, then? Sure he was.
Bassett Hound, yes, he was. Yes, he was. Another Leicester connection.
Yeah.
But we got to the final. Again, 73,000-odd people plus there. It was 0-0 going... Well, it was 1-0, because, again, as always in these playoff finals, we went a goal down.
Yeah.
They scored after 14 minutes, but then it was getting a little bit tight, and 75th minute, 76th minute, Muzzy is it, breaks into the box and gets taken out,
yeah.
With Gary Parker, who stood up to take the penalty.
Yeah, yeah. He had plenty of confidence, that guy, I tell you. Plenty of confidence. But I can't remember too much of the game, you know. It's weird, isn't it? Considering it was extra time and everything. Oh, no, it was going in, wasn't it? Gareth Southgate played for Palace then, did he, or not?
Yeah, well, Nigel Martin was in goal. Pitcher, yeah. Edgeworthy, Brown, Tuttle, Quinn, Hopkin, Roberts, Horton, Friedman and Nadar. The substitutes were Vart, Roger and Bruce Dyer. And the manager was David Allison on that one, who is actually my nephew. No, my cousin. My cousin is David Allison, not him. Not him, but it is the same guy. And of course, like we say, heading towards penalties, we thought, here we go again. Heading towards penalties, and the Crystal Palace players admit it put them off. They don't think anybody's expecting a goalkeeper. That classic comment as he walked on. I mentioned it earlier. Don't worry, boss, I'll win it for you. And I remember whether it was David Pleat or whoever was co-commentating on the TV, his comment was, I'm surprised they're making the change because Kevin Poole's always struck me as a good stop shotter. But Kalich was 7'8" or something, wasn't he? It was ridiculous. Never had a good time at Leicester. But went on to play for AC Milan.
He didn't really get much of a chance at Leicester, from memory.
No. He had one really, really bad game, and he was at fault for like 3 goals. He was like Dracula. Mm. You know, he wouldn't come out for crosses.
Yeah, he didn't settle in too well, did he?
No. But like I say, he ended up at AC Milan. I mean, what an end to a game.
Yeah, and the other issue, I think, we were more worried about losing, not because of not going up, but I think there was a rumour around that Heskey was going to leave at the end of the season. This could be his last game for Leicester.
Right.
and I don't know who was after him, probably Liverpool, but that was his boyhood club, allegedly, wasn't it? And obviously they got him in the end, but I think if we hadn't gone up, he'd have gone earlier because he was a superstar in that championship, whatever it's called then. Was a championship, wasn't it? And you know, there's no way he would have stayed another year in there, as I don't think would some of the others.
No.
Muzzy, is it, was after Chelsea. I think Chelsea were trying to buy him back. We not signed him then, we got him on loan still then, I think, hadn't we?
I think we had, yes. He was in their reserves. He wouldn't even made it into their first team.
No.
O'Neill was jubilant and thankful a penalty shootout was avoided. We just about deserved to win it, and that's an understatement. We played well, but we didn't fancy penalties. Bassett said, this is the third time I've done this and third time I've lost. Neil Robinson in The Guardian reported that O'Neill was given a £5 million budget to make additions to the Leicester City squad, which was a lot for us in them days. You know, I mean, when you come to think, that budget was what Peter Taylor spent on Akinbaye. I know. The following season, Leicester, of course, we finished ninth, went on to win the League Cup that season. Crystal Palace finished sixth and went up via the playoffs themselves, beating Sheffield United.
Yeah.
But those were our two wins. It was our fifth... winning the final marked Leicester City's fifth promotion since we were relegated in the 68-69 season. Memories. But we didn't need, as it happened, another playoff final, which was bloody good because we didn't do very well at all. And these are where the memories actually get rather, what can I say? Shit, basically, I think is the word. We'll be back after this.
Hello, Matt Elliott here.
Hi, Alan Smith here.
Hey guys, Ian Hume here.
Hi everybody, Jerry Taggart here.
Be sure to watch
Chris and Leicester Till I Die TV
for all the latest Leicester City news and information.
You can also subscribe on YouTube and various social media channels
for the latest updates and news on Leicester City Football Club.
Come on, you foxes!
Indeed. And I've just got to say, like I say, thank you to Doug who's popped in. And indeed, like my tweet from earlier, and I felt a little bit naughty. I'd got a bit of time on my hands. You know, I don't waste my time, Dave, do I? But I did put this out earlier. It was, who's had the better career? Both of them there playing for Leicester. And the reason I put this up as well is because this is going to come up in a sec, in a minute. Harry Kane and Jamie Vardy, both there behind Nigel Pearson on the subs bench. Kane has won three golden Premier League Golden Boots, which is a bit odd because they come in pairs. He's twice won the Premier League Player of the Year. On the other hand, old Jamie Vardy has managed to win one Premier League Golden Boot, one Conference Golden Boot, one English Premier League Player of the Year. He's won one English Championship, one FA Cup, one Community Shield, and one Premier League. Ah, oh, Jamie, we're proud of you, mate. We're proud of you. But, I mean, poor Harry Kane. What can you say? But... anyway, let me bring you more up to date. This will make
you get on tonight. Did they get through the Champions League or not?
Oh, I've no idea.
Do we care?
No, we don't. We don't.
Oh, this one was painful.
Yes. We didn't get to the final in 2010, but we got through to the semis. Four teams in the playoff were Forest, Cardiff. Forest had finished third with 79, Cardiff fourth with 76. Leicester fifth with 76, and Blackpool, who would go on to win the final, finished sixth with 70. And I've got to say, well done to them for knocking Blackpool out, of course. First leg, we got 8th of May. We played at Filbert Street, and we lost 1-0 to Cardiff City. 78th minute goal from Guy Whittingham. Now, there's a name from the past. Second leg came along, and where are we? It was 2-3 after extra time. Fryett put Leicester ahead on the 25th minute. Had equalised for Leicester on the 25th minute, 4 minutes after Chopra had put a scored for Cardiff. Hudson then went and scored an own goal for Cardiff, making it, that would make it 2-2. King, Andy King, got a goal on the 49th minute. Whittingham then got a penalty in the... Again, a penalty! Every love story you look at for Leicester's always got a penalty around it, hasn't it? Guy Whittingham got a 69th. He could have gone on to have a great career if he'd moved clubs. The referee here was Howard Webb. And it went to penalties. I'm afraid I'm going to have to take this through for you here, Dave.
No.
Chopra scored for Cardiff. I'm not sure what order this was in. Burner. I think Burner went first. Sorry. So Burner scored. Bloody hell, Burner. Do you remember him? Scored for Leicester. Chopra scored for Cardiff. Howard. Do you remember Howard?
Yeah, I do.
Maybe Howard scored for Leicester. McCormack equalised for Cardiff. Solano. Good God. Yeah. Scored for Leicester. Ledley scored for Cardiff. And then we had the moment that you can see up above. And I have to admit, I do feel kind of sorry for Jan Kermagrant on this. I don't think you should ever try a Panenka. Is that what they're called? I don't think you should ever try one of these, especially not in a you know, playoff final or an FA Cup or any final. Had that gone in, though, he would have been hailed as a star, wouldn't he?
Well, yeah, but that was ridiculous. You know, I mean, it was so slow. The keeper had time to fall over and get up and get it.
Yes.
I mean, the fact that I think he kicked it out in the end, did he? I don't know. But
it was... I know he went down and then he kind of went back and got it with his hand or something.
His hand, was it? Yeah, it was horrendous time. I couldn't believe it. Couldn't believe it.
He was
a decent player, actually, as well. He didn't get many games for us, I don't think.
I don't think we really saw him again after that.
No, he wasn't a bad player.
He went on to have a decent career at Bournemouth, believe it or not, of all places. And I think he may well have scored against us, if I am.
He did.
Not
he did. Yeah, I remember that.
Mistaken. Yeah.
He did.
Which is always going to happen, isn't it, really?
Wasn't much to ask, though, was it, really? Just hit the bloody thing.
Yeah, and the funny thing is, I don't know if you remember, when he was walking back to the centre circle, not one Leicester City player was consoling him.
Yeah, it was a bad moment.
I mean, Jan Kermagrant, he actually played 20 games for us. I'm not sure whether he actually, we bought him off YouTube, you know, I've just watched him on YouTube. Do you know how many goals he scored for us?
Not as many as he should have done. One.
We then put him out on loan to Aries Avignon, back in France. 26 games, 3 goals. He then went on to Charlton Athletic for 3 seasons. And he scored 89 goals. Sorry, played 89 games and scored 28 goals.
Okay.
And then he went to AFC Bournemouth, where he played 2 seasons, played 61 games, got 24 goals, and then went to Reading for 2 seasons, scoring 23 goals in 84 games. Before any of Vons, again, who I'm guessing were in France.
He wasn't a bad player. He wasn't a bad player. Just
do you know? He retired. He only retired on the 22nd of April 2020. And of course, they went and then scored the next goal, Kennedy. And do you remember who went stood up to take our last goal, which we needed to score to go through to the final?
No.
What did you have for breakfast yesterday?
I do know.
Still playing, I believe, Martin Waghorn.
Waghorn, was he? Yeah.
Who basically we had on loan and did really, really well for us. But then, if you remember Sunderland, I think it was from, absolutely held out for like something like £3 million or something ridiculous.
Oh.
Martin Waghorn actually played 60 games for Leicester and scored 8 goals, though. Waghorn joined Leicester City on loan in August 2009.
Most of those while he was on loan with us, I think.
Yeah. On the 31st of August, Waghorn rejoined Leicester City on a permanent deal for a fee rising to £3 million to help fund Sunderland's record signing, Amosowa Gyan. After us, we sold him to Wigan Athletic. He never was he was at Derby, 111 games at Derby, but he only got 26 goals. But my memory of that match, well, wasn't just Jan Kermagrant penalty. It was, like I say, the players' reaction to him when he walked back. Nobody was going up and consoling him. And of course, Martin Waghorn went up, smashed it. I'm not sure whether it hit the bar and went over or it just went over on its own. I don't know if you remember at all.
I thought it just went over.
Did it? But yeah, all the Leicester players and thing were really consoling him because he'd fallen. He was laid on his back crying. Yeah. And yeah, everybody was still ignoring Kermagant.
Yeah.
never really much to play again for us after that, you know.
It was a weird game. Very weird game.
It was. Guys, if you feeling generous, please subscribe to the channel. It does help us. If you also want to smash the likes, that is a big help as well. It does get us seen on channels that don't follow us, and hopefully we'll get them to follow us. And if you want there, as you can see, only £1.99 of your good English pounds per month to show your support and become a member. I can't remember off the top of my head. One of the things you get discount on merchandise. You get you get into the community group on YouTube, which is just for members. We did have gold, silver and bronze, but in these tough times financially, as Dave will tell you, I got rid of the gold and silver, merged them all into one and just charging the bronze price. I was a fool to myself, really, because David ended up paying less.
I got a refund.
You did? You got a refund from me. That's the sort of guy. And I knew you would get a refund because it does come up and warn you. And I thought, no. That's the sort of guy I am. I didn't mind doing that. I'm thinking of the time. But look.
I checked my bank account. I thought it had bounced or something.
The question is, think that was the worst defeat in the semis or was this?
I think this one felt worse.
Yes.
I didn't expect to win it. I must confess at the time. Again, I was playing cricket and I didn't get to the second leg, but I thought, it doesn't look good. We weren't playing particularly well. So I thought, okay, fair enough. And Watford weren't a bad side. And Deeney, I think, scoring for England at the time. I mean, he was just knocking them away.
Yeah.
But to do it like that, I think you said to me earlier, it wasn't a penalty anyway, I don't think, was it?
I don't think it was.
No.
I mean, we'd lost the first leg, or I'm just trying to get it up now.
It was 1-1.
Was it 1-1 the first leg?
Yeah. Yeah. That didn't look good.
No, No. Let's just have a look. Yeah, so... no, it was 1-0 to Leicester, the first leg. First leg was 1-0 to Leicester.
1-0, that's it, yeah.
And then the second leg was 3-1, obviously, to Watford. Nugent scored for Leicester City in the first leg on the 62nd minute. And let's be honest with you, at that point, you thought, it's all looking good. That was at the King Power Stadium, I think, or was it the Walkers then? I'm not sure. And then, of course, we came to the second leg. Ah, Vicarage Road, we went down to. Probably one of the best, well, I don't think so for me, but it's always getting repeated around whenever the Sky is showing the playoff final. The gentleman that you can see on the screen there having an absolute orgasm when that third goal went in for Watford. Now, what I was going to say was, do you know who was in the team for us that day?
Well, Schmeichel was in goal, wasn't he?
Schmeichel was in goal, yes.
I think Walsh had gone by then, hadn't he? Wasn't playing. Who did we have? Is it? No, sorry. What are we talking about? We're talking about 2013. Okay.
Let me tell you, there was one player I want to get to. But the actual lineup was Schmeichel in goal. Schluck was left back. Keane was, I think we got him on loan.
He was
centre back with Morgan, who was captain. De Laat was on the right. Knockyart left midfield. James in the middle with Dyer. I like Dyer. And Andy King on the right. And then Nugent and Chris Wood up front, who I think went on to score our first goal in the Premier League, to be honest with you. But Chris Wood was substituted, and he was substituted on the 76th minute, I believe it was, which I will tell you now, 61 minutes, Chris Wood was taken off. Do you remember who came on for him?
I guess about then Vardy.
No, you should have gone for the other one, Harry Kane.
Harry Kane.
Yes.
I'd forgotten he ever played for us.
Yeah, well, he was obviously on loan. Whatever happened to him?
No. He'll never make it.
No, he'll never win a trophy. But yes, he actually came on in the 61st minute for Chris Wood. Chris Wood had got a booking, so possibly that was why he was taken off.
Yeah, that's
You know, I mean, it was what it went 1-0. Vidra scored. He went on to play a long, long time for Burnley. A left-footed shot, and it was his first goal of the season. Who knew? David Nugent equalised with a header on the 19th minute. So only 4 minutes later, second goal of the season. And then Vidra got his second to make it 2-1. On the 65th minute, we then got a penalty. Now then, I remember watching that with my two boys, and I was jumping up and down, and Simon, my youngest of my two boys, was jumping up and down with me, and Sean said, "Nah, they've got to score it first." And now I still blame him to this day that he cursed that penalty. But I think it was I don't think that would have been given if we'd had VAR.
No.
And in a way, I'm not saying justice was done by them scoring, but justice was done because it was saved. Because he touched his back and he went down, you know, like a Flosby flop sort of thing. And there's no way, I don't think you could claim that was a penalty. But, of course, Knockyart, who wasn't really our penalty taker.
No, Nugent was, wasn't he?
Hmm. But obviously he'd won it, and he felt confident. And let's be honest with you, he could have had a good career with us, Knockyart. I like Knockyart. He had a sweet foot on him. I can remember him scoring a goal in a game. I was down the pub watching it. We were playing Sheffield Wednesday, and I said, he's going to put this free kick in the top left-hand corner. Top bins, straight away. So he could do it. So I wasn't overly worried. Hmm. Obviously, it was saved. It was saved by Almunia, who was the Watford goalkeeper at the time. It was the 97th minute, this was. It was a huge call by the referee, in fairness. And he then saved the rebound as well.
Oh, yeah.
And then, of course, the rest, as they say, up the other end. And the rest is history.
We had a strong bench then, didn't we, when you think about it?
Well, the substitutes here were Conrad Logan.
Drinkwater,
who came on for Dyer. Okay. He came on the 66th minute as well. Liam Moore.
Yeah.
Paul Konchesky.
Yeah.
Ben Marshall. I always liked Ben Marshall, I've got to be honest with you.
Yeah, me too, but he messed up, didn't he?
Yes. And you know, and not only interesting fact number two, because interesting fact number one was that Harry Kane came on for Chris Woods, is the fact that Harry Kane came on and Jamie Vardy didn't.
No. Doesn't seem to make sense now, does it?
But... No, now it doesn't.
Maybe hold the ball up like a similar player to Wood, wasn't he, Kane?
Yeah. Maybe if Kane had taken the penalty, but then again, maybe not after the World Cup.
Good call. Two penalty takers on the pitch.
Yeah. In fairness to Jamie Vardy, I don't think he was feeling like it was going well for him at the time.
He had a bad start, didn't he?
He did. Yeah, he nearly kind of actually... was going to quit football. And, of course, it was only the next season, I think probably that Man United game when he came in, you know, into it, basically. But the final was between Watford and Palace. It went to extra time. And they won it, Palace, by a penalty, as if you wouldn't believe it. And Palace had knocked, obviously, local... Well, to them, their derby game, which is Brighton and Hove Albion. And since, of course, the next season, we absolutely walked the division.
It was I think, if I remember at the time reading it or hearing about it, Nigel Pearson took the management team away for a week or something in a retreat to try and get it out of their system and said, look, you know, it's done. That's it. If we go up next year, it'll all be forgotten. And I think he did a brilliant management job there.
The way
he did that and kept the heads up and said, look, we can have another go. We know we're good enough. We'll sign a couple more players.
Yeah.
And they did. And they murdered it, didn't they?
Oh, unbelievable. They murdered it. I mean, that season, let me just see if I can get it up. Because I can remember I went up to Burnley. What season would that be? 2013-14, wasn't it? No,
it was 2014-15. 14-15, yeah.
Yeah. Let's have a look. Here we go. We absolutely murdered it. I remember going up to Burnley and... Leicester were hosting Burnley on my birthday. And, of course, I'd lived in Burnley for 20-odd years, worked for the Burnley Express.
Yeah.
And one of my good friends, Janet, bless her. I mean, she literally, once I got there, she was my taxi all weekend. She was so nice. And I met up with a lot of people that I'd worked with, et cetera, et cetera. But she said, have you got your ticket yet? And I said, no, I'm actually going to get it within the next couple of days. And she said, don't bother. you're coming into, because they didn't actually have boxes as such, but they had one big room with big tables on. You're going to come onto the Burnley Express table. Mm-hmm. I'm like, wow, okay, thank you very much. And so, of course, I had the full, you know, three course meal and all the extras. And I was sat, obviously, you sat in the, you know, the box, you know, those seats that are reserved for people that had been in the in this lounge. And I was the only one up cheering when Leicester City scored. And I remember the woman next to me was a West Ham fan, and she turned to me, which wasn't on our table, she turned to me and went, "But you're having a happy birthday." And that one that Chris Wood scored, he was on the left wing and he scored it from, well, hang on a second. Was that the season? No, I don't think it was that season.
It was 13-14. Did Burnley go up with us that year?
Yes, they did. They went up in second. 14-15 was the relegation year. That was the Great Escape.
Because then, yeah, 14, that's right.
And then 15-16.
That's right. So sure. That was in the Premier League then.
Yeah, I'm not sure what happened, other than the fact that we won that thing behind me.
Well, we scored over 100 points, I think, didn't we? Which was quite impressive.
I'm going to have to start listening to you, aren't I? You give me the wrong information.
Sorry, mate.
That's all right. What did you have for breakfast?
No idea.
Let's have a look here. But we had... Leicester City, 2013 to 2014... We broke virtually every record that was going.
Well, we won shed loads of games. I remember that. Oh, we kept winning all the time.
We got that knocked out the FA Cup in the third round and the League Cup in the fifth round, so we could concentrate, as they say.
Yeah.
The pre-season, we'd beaten Leamington 2-0. We drew with Ilkeson. We beat Port Vale 1-0. We drew with York. We beat Corby 3-2. We then went on to lose to AS Monaco. We lost to Northampton Town and we lost to Colville Town. But then when we got into the, let's have a look, this events, Wes Morgan is called up to play for Jamaica and he signs a 1-year contract extension.
Yeah.
Paul Konchesky signs a 1-year contract extension. Gary Taylor Fletcher, do you remember him? Signs a 1-year contract extension. Marcin Wazalewski, wow, signs a 1-year contract extension. He could have had whatever he wanted. I don't think anybody would have argued with him. Riyad Mahrez plays for Algeria for the first time. Now James Pearson signs a 1-year contract extension. Schmeichel signs a 4-year extension. Drinkwater signs a 4-year extension. Nigel Pearson signs a 3-year contract extension. So a lot of contract extensions there. And the squad, Schmeichel, Conrad Logan and Adam Smith in goal. Defenders, Richard Delap, Paul Konchesky, Wes Morgan, Zach Whitbread, good God. Sean St. Ledger, Jeff Schlupp, Liam Moore, Zumanan Bakayogo, Ingazi Miguel. And Marcin Wazalewski. Midfielders, Drinkwater, Marshall, Dean Hammond, Matty James, Andy King, Lloyd Dyer. He was a lovely player, Lloyd Dyer. Neil Danz, Anthony Knockyart, and Riyad Mahrez. And the forwards were Vardy, Waghorn, Gallagher, loved his penalties, Tom Hopper, Gary Taylor Fletcher. He always looked like the dad that was going on, didn't he? Marco Fuchtas, bloody hell. David Nugent and Chris Wood. And we just literally, we just tore into them. We did lose Kevin Phillips. He retired. Yeah. Ben Marshall.
Did he not stay on the coaching staff?
He did. He did. Yeah. I remember as well, the other game I remember from this season was Bournemouth. So we went down to, but Bournemouth had got, were obviously in the same league as us. When did we go to Bournemouth and have a lovely time of day? We went to Bournemouth. Was it this season or was it the season before? No, it could have been the season.
I can't remember that.
No, it could have been the season before. So I won't tell the story because obviously it isn't relevant. So, we finished first. We got 102 points. We scored 83 goals. We won 31 matches. We only lost 6, although Burnley unfortunately only lost 5. We were first. Burnley were second.
Rangers got up that year, did they as well? Was that Rangers?
They qualified by the playoffs.
Yeah. I think who they beat. Not Watford, was it? Who did they beat?
Wigan or Derby?
Yeah, it's maybe somebody like that.
They only show me the 3 teams for some reason. Mm. But from our 22nd game, which would have been on the 26th of December, we beat Reading 1-0. We were top for the whole season.
Yeah.
It was just... We were winning, and we were breaking records left, right and centre. It was a great season, and we didn't need the playoffs, did we?
No, that was the biggest relief, really, because even though we'd done 2, the last 2 were awful, so that we didn't want to get in the playoffs again.
No,
and then made sure we didn't. It was a sensational season.
What a reaction to what had happened the previous season. You know,
and David, we thought we were set up for it, really did, for the next season.
David Nugent scored 20 goals and Jamie Vardy 16 that season. Yeah. Gary Taylor Fletcher got 3. Good old Gary.
He's an ambassador, isn't he, at Southampton there?
Is he?
I think so, because he was commenting on the before the game on Saturday. He was saying that Southampton would probably win it. Weren't wrong, was he?
No, he wasn't wrong at all. Let's just have a look. We won 35 out of 52 games. Our win percentage was 67.31. Biggest win was 5-2. The heaviest defeat was 4-1 against Brighton. It was just an amazing season. And since then, and hopefully moving forward, we are still going to be in the Premier League.
Yeah, I think so. I've done a weird thing. You know, I used to do this when I was...
More weird than normal.
Yeah, I've done a thing about where everybody's going to finish.
All right. Do
how many games, you know.
Yeah.
So I've got... Actually, it's nothing very exciting. It's the same positions they're in now, I think. So we're going to end up on 39 points, I think, finish 14th. Forest will be 17th. And then Everton, Saints and Bournemouth will go down, according to my guesstimate.
We might have to do a show on that, you know.
It's not a bad idea. I tell you, it's interesting to see that Forest have only got to play 4 of the bottom clubs around them, whereas Palace have got to play 7. And Southampton and Everton have only got to play 4 around them as well.
We've got a difficult run coming up, though, haven't we?
Well, we got, maybe Chelsea home, Brentford away, Palace away, Villa at home, Bournemouth home. It's not bad, is it?
Well, I don't know. When you can't beat Southampton,
well,
you've got to ask, haven't you?
Apparently, we played well. It was just the taking the chances.
Yes.
Yeah, that's not the way I saw it on the day, but there you go.
Yeah. Dave, thank you so much for tonight.
You're welcome. Bloody hell, it's nearly 11 o'clock.
It is. It is. Go I'm going to turn into a pumpkin. Some would say I already have.
You do go on.
I'm correcting everything you're telling me that's wrong.
Good job Brad's not here, isn't it? Be here till 1 o'clock in the morning.
I never said that.
No, you didn't. No, I only thought.
You mean Brad and his friend the Echo? Anyway, if you can stay online, I'll have a very quick word with you when I finish the show. Mate. So don't go. But thank you very much. When is your next prog rock on Surrey Hills Radio?
Actually, I haven't recorded it yet, but it's going to be the first Saturday in April, whenever that is.
Well, a couple of weeks off you. We will speak a couple of times before then, but check out. You can always go on to Mixcloud and probably on surreyhillsradio.co.uk as well and check out.
Check them all out.
Check all of them out, exactly. Yeah. Indeed. If you like your bit of prog rock, that's your show. Dave, thank you very much, mate. And I will see you next Monday.
Indeed.
Yeah. All see the best, guys. Mate. Take care. Thank you. Bye bye. Rich is in. Cheers, buddy. Thank you for that. How are you? I predicted a 3-1 win for you. But hey, it's at the end of the day, it's only 3 points. And I just, got to be honest with you, I just loved Gary Neville's face. But I still think you'll get top four and finish in Europe in the Champions League places. I really do. I think Ten Hag's turned it around quicker than I thought he would. So unlucky. But I think you'll have a good end of the season. I will be back tomorrow, 9 o'clock. It's the preview show. We're going to have, a Chelsea, hopefully, guy coming on to join us and also a Chelsea pre-record. And obviously be myself and Craig doing the match. Thank you so very much for Dave. We are both going to turn into pumpkins very, very quickly. Mrs. Dave is probably saying, trying to drag him to bed as we speak, which is probably why he doesn't want to go. But here we go. Thanks very much, guys. I'll see you tomorrow at 9. All the best. Thank you for watching Left Little I Die TV, YouTube, and on Twitch, and listening on your favourite podcast platform. Good night now. And as always, here's Arnie.
Thanks for watching. These videos are tremendous. You'd better like them too, or I'll be back.
This podcast is proud to be part of the TalkSport Fan Network.
TalkSport. Powered by fans.
That's all, folks.
Thanks for watching Leicester Till I Die. This is Chris saying goodbye, and see you next time.
Looking for Dr. Goodhead.